you've got this new tool, right, that's helping compare the plethora of large language models that are out there and see whether they fit your business case in particular. Adam, just talk us through, well, ultimately, this anxiety that lays deep that we're just talking about, whether you think it's, well, vindicated?
Well, I think, you know, it's very understandable, the anxiety. I mean, when you interact with ChatGPT or some of these other systems, you really kind of, it's breathtaking, right, how human-like the responses are. But fortunately, look, AI has been being deployed in a lot in the last 5 years and accelerating every year. And unemployment's still historically low. And there's very, very little evidence that AI is taking jobs. It is evolving jobs. It's evolving jobs quickly, but there's not mass job loss coming from it that's been observed anywhere.
So we go back to the Cisco story. What we know is that companies are investing either way. They're thinking about the use of large language models. The way that I see Arthur Bench, your product, is like when I'm buying a new laptop, right? I go into a grid side by side, I compare processing power, I compare the memory, I compare operating system. You're basically offering the equivalent for companies to choose the best LLM for them.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the important thing is that you can test it on exactly what you want to do with it, right? And so the way you use your laptop is different from maybe the way my high schooler does or the way my father does. And so you want to know, how's this going to perform for me? And so I have like my own kind of proprietary data that I want to feed into the LLM, and I want to ask it certain types of questions, put certain types of prompts in that. And there's a lot of really nuanced differences that can't be reduced down to just a single number on a leaderboard. And so that's where Arthur Bench comes in. It allows people to really test like the kinds of prompts that their users are providing with their data and see how it performs.
No. LLM, Caroline, large language model, it's just become a blanket term.
Yeah.
But there's such variation between sort of the multiple billions of parameters large language model and something for everyone out there.
Yeah, and I mean, I go back to when you and I first started doing the show together. It was November and what came out the gate, but ChatGPT that really seemed to set the world alight. And Adam, to that point, you know, when you're looking at the nuances within the large language models, how are we seeing them differentiate? And in particular, for example, it feels like Anthropic is on a bit of a roll recently with Claude 2.
Yeah, Claude 2 has been great in our testing. It's doing a good job of not answering questions when it should be answering questions and not answering when it doesn't know the answer. And so there's, you know, that can be very important. Yeah, Claude 2 definitely performs impressively. You know, there's also, we see big differences in terms of the way they hedge, for instance. And so some of the models are much more likely to not want to answer a question and to say, hey, I'm an LLM, I shouldn't be answering this, or it's not my place. And so depending on the application, that may be appropriate or it may be a big drawback. And so that's why those are some of the differences that our testing and our tool can tease out for people.
Adam, how do we democratize AI technology, access to it, so that we lower the threshold, right, where you don't need to have control of all the NVIDIA H100s or billions of dollars for the training? How does that happen?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a big concern right now, access to that hardware, both the expense and just the availability of it. I think fortunately these systems will become more efficient over time. And, you know, there are other vendors who are starting to make hardware, more capacity coming online. It's going to take a little while until that happens. But the nice thing with open source models is you can get a pre-trained model that you can either just use or modify. And so, you know, what Facebook's done with Llama V2 and a number of other people have done with the open release of these models, that's really put them in the hands of a lot of people who might not have had access to them before.
Can Arthur make money with this business model, particularly if we move towards an increasingly open sourced world?
Yeah, absolutely. There are things that we do that are proprietary, like our ability to detect and block hallucinations. And so not everything we do is open source, but in this case, we just felt it was really important because this is sort of a feeling confident that you're making the right choice about your system and that you can put it out in production and trust that it goes well is a major impediment for a lot of people. And we really saw it slowing down people in the process of deploying. And ultimately, what's good for us is for as many people as possible to put these systems into production so that we can protect and monitor them. And so the reason we open source this is just to sort of accelerate people's ability to deploy these tools in a responsible way in an enterprise.
ultimately, though, your own business of Arthur is about making money, and you're backed by what? Index Ventures, Accrued Capital, Greycroft, and the like. I'm interested as to the groundswell of hype and reality. How much are you seeing companies coming to you wanting to get your services, wanting to understand where they put their money to work in AI LLMs?
Yeah, it's been unlike anything I've ever seen in my career. And I think it's because, you know, ChatGPT is just so accessible. Anyone can go in and play around with it and see just the power of it. And so it's become a board level issue at everything from Fortune 100s down to every single startup, where boards are asking the CEO and the CIO, what is our generative AI strategy and how is it going to transform our business? And so that sense of urgency has cascaded through the organization. And so we're seeing all sorts of project teams mobilizing and working on ways to transform some of the key leverage points in their business using LLMs. And it's just been breathtaking to see. And so that's what we come in. A lot of times they call us to help them because it's, you know, there's a lot of little details that collectively are a little bit daunting when you're trying to stand up one of these systems, even though ultimately it's pretty accessible technology. There's certainly a learning curve, and we help a lot of our customers with that, as well as solving some of the common deployment challenges around hallucinations and prompt injection and leaking sensitive data, things like that.